I bless you. Let them know that they bless you this morning. Let them know. I appreciate you praying for me. I appreciate you praying for me. Amen. 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 If you have your Bibles, would you turn with me to the Gospel according to St. Luke? Luke's Gospel, chapter number 14. Luke chapter number 14, there are some words of challenge there for us as we contemplate now more about what it means to live an unleashed life. We've been saying now, this is our comprehensive theme for the year, that we are trying to embrace unleashed in every sense of the word, that we want to see our lives be free of the things that have kept us bound. I want to be free from a judgmental spirit unleashed. I want to be free from the shackles of debt. I want to be free. I want to be free from the throes of addiction. I want to be free. I want to live an unleashed life. That, in other words, I want to live a life of blessing where I live up to my fullest potential, experiencing and receiving all that God desires to give me. That's the kind of life that I want. And so I want to challenge you and press you a little further and share with you, you know what, that life does not come easy, and that life does not come free, amen? Luke chapter 14, beginning with verse 25, these are the words of Jesus. Large crowds were traveling with Jesus, and turning to them, he said, "If anyone comes to me and does not hate his father and mother, his wife and children, his brothers and sisters, yes, even his own life, he cannot be my disciple. And anyone who does not carry his cross and follow me cannot be my disciple." Suppose one of you wants to build a tower. Will he not first sit down and estimate the cost to see if he has enough money to complete it? For if he lays the foundation and is not able to finish it, everyone who sees it will ridicule him, saying, "This fellow began to build and was not able to finish." Or suppose one of you wants to build a tower. Or suppose a king is about to go to war against another king. Will he not first sit down and consider whether he is able with 10,000 men to oppose the one coming against him with 20,000. If he is not able, he will send a delegation while the other is still a long way off and will ask for terms of peace. In the same way, any of you who does not give up everything he has cannot be my disciple. I want to talk today from this thought, the cost of unleashing. The cost of unleashing. Today is, in case you didn't know, this afternoon's going to be a little contest. Right? Going to be a little ball game coming on this evening. It's called the what? The Super Bowl. It is the largest sports stage on the planet. There is no larger sporting event in the world than the Super Bowl. And they call the winner of the Super Bowl the world champions, yet they only play this game in one part of the world. Nonetheless, the Super Bowl today. Thousands of people from all over the place will descend on the city of Houston. They've been having festivities all week long. I remember when the last time the Super Bowl was in Houston, we were there, and we went to the NFL experience. There was a festive event for fans and all of that there at the stadium, and we went to that. Didn't go to the game because we couldn't afford the game, but we could go to the NFL experience. And you could feel the electricity. You could feel the energy in the air. You could feel all of the excitement and the enthusiasm as people were hyped. They were ready to cheer for the team. And then there were people there who could care less who was playing. It was the Super Bowl. And in fact, it was just a major event, and it didn't matter who was playing. But if your team was playing, man, it was extra special. Well, our teams didn't make it this year. Not this year. But we are still, there's still, I'm sure, some excitement about the Super Bowl. Somebody's got a whole mess of wings that you plan to either prepare or pick up for tonight. Somebody's got some taco dip they're getting ready to make. Somebody's got some beverages. Somebody's got some company coming over. Or you got plans to go somewhere. And some of y'all going to these places and don't even know who playing in the Super Bowl. But you going anyway to the Super Bowl party. Do you know that now you would pay anywhere from $100, $200, $300 for a jersey with Matt Ryan's name on the back of it? You could pay $200, $300, $500 for a jersey with Tom Brady's name on the back of it. You could pay top dollar for, you know, people were renting their homes around Energy Stadium in Houston, Texas. These folk had regular modest homes and they were renting them for $5,000 a night. Could you imagine? I wish I was still in Houston just for the weekend. You would find my picture and my house on the internet. You could rent my house for a couple of days for $4,000 a night. I'd give it to you for a bargain. But still, there is all of this excitement about the Super Bowl. People are wearing jerseys and people are acting, I mean, they are just acting out of their minds. They have been partying since Thursday, getting ready for the Super Bowl. But let me tell you something. You can go and buy a jersey. You can buy a helmet. You can buy shoulder pads. You can buy the entire uniform, cleats, get your ankles taped up, everything, and still will not be on the team. You can go through all of those measures. You can even work out, lift weights, and run laps, and do all of that stuff. Yell at the TV, and it will not change the course of the game on the field because you are not a part of the team. What that makes you is an extreme fan. And you know what? Here in the text, the Bible says that crowds followed Jesus. There were people who were following him that were in his entourage. I mean, they were just giddy because they were in the company of Jesus, and all they were fans, but they were not disciples. And I need to tell you something today, that we sometimes, Jesus is a rock star. We will wear the t-shirts and wear the jewelry and buy the paraphernalia. We will get crosses etched in our scalps. We will get tattoos on our arms. We will put scriptures on our bodies. We will do all kind of stuff, but we would be nothing more than fans. Running around, we're saying that we're going to live unleashed in 2017, and it's going to be a better year for me, and God's going to get more out of me. God's going to do more for me. You just watch. I'm going to be so and so and so and so and so and so. But guess what? If there is no significant commitment and investment, if we are not trying to be disciples of Jesus Christ, we will be nothing more than one of his fans. But I don't believe that we want to be just fans. I don't believe that we want to be groupies. I really believe that we want to be disciples. Jesus is not looking for fans, but he is looking for disciples. And so to be a true follower of Jesus Christ, you must be willing to pay that cost. And paying that cost, I'm not talking about you be willing to fill out an offering envelope and put something in it. But when we talk about paying the cost, we're talking about what does it really mean to be a real and genuine follower of Jesus Christ. I want to lead a congregation that takes discipleship seriously. I want us to be a people and be a real people of faith and not a people of hype. I don't want us to have stellar concerts on Sunday morning. I want us to be people that are mobilized to put our faith in action. And when we put our faith in action, that action is called our discipleship. So then, unleash means that there is an understanding of and a willingness to pay this cost. That's what it means to be unleashed. Now, I'm going to tell you now, this sermon, it's going to be a little different than last week's sermon. Now, last week, we got excited over the Lord will make a way somehow. He still will make a way. But also, this week, it's going to be about, but you're going to have to pay something somehow. This is going to cost you something somehow. So then, let me tell you something. You can't allow discipleship to be cheapened by a shallow, superficial commitment. Don't let your discipleship be strictly about the t-shirt that you wear or the songs that you sing or the locality, the location of the place where you worship. That doesn't make you a disciple. But discipleship has to do with the expression of your faith and how you've invested yourself in what it is that you say you believe in. Because, you know, a lot of folk talk about what they believe in, but they don't have any significant investment in it. Jesus knows it's not my place to go around and say who's a real Christian and who's not. But through this sermon, you're going to be evaluating yourself. First point is this. It is the relationship with Christ that is most important. Well, you see, Jesus was telling and teaching in some parables, the parable of the great banquet. He was helping them understand what really matters to God. And so there were these large crowds traveling with Jesus, and they were just with him because of the fact that it made them feel like they were somebody to be with Jesus. It was, and you know, you can be with Jesus but not really be with him. You know, there are people who can be with you, but they just with you. They just kind of in the same space where you are, but they aren't with you. They're not down for you. They're not willing to invest in you. And we don't want to be those kind of people. We want to be disciples. And so Jesus challenges them. Jesus says, if anyone comes to me and does not hate his father, his mother, his wife, his children, his brothers, his sisters, even his own life, he cannot be my disciple. Man, that's rough, isn't it? Jesus went straight gangster. Jesus is like, you got to be willing to hate your mama and your daddy and your wife and your children, even your own self. Now, for those of us who, you know, let me just help you. Jesus is not telling you to go home and tell your mama you hate her. That ain't going to go over well. Jesus is not telling you to go tell your wife, I hate you. Certainly don't tell your children, I hate you. But what Jesus is saying, he's telling us that these relationships, all of them still cannot hold a place of prominence over your relationship with me. Jesus is saying that your love for mama cannot exceed your love for me. Your love for your boo cannot exceed your love for me. And as cute and cuddly as your babies are, still you cannot love them more than you love me. And it's not, and guess what? Does it make Jesus selfish? Absolutely. But guess what? He's Jesus. And Jesus knows that you wouldn't have mama if it wasn't for me. And you wouldn't have daddy if it wasn't for me. There'd be no brother and sister. There'd be no children were it not for my grace in your life. Therefore, there can be no other persons who receive greater devotion than Jesus Christ. You remember the message I preached when we talked about how we got to lay aside every weight and sin that so easily entangles and besets us, that you know that your spouse, your family, your familial relationships can completely undermine your discipleship. You can be so wrapped up into your marriage that you completely miss God. And that is a very real fact. When we work with couples, we try to help couples understand that the marriage relationship is a covenant between two people and God. And when we try to make marriage be only about what happens between the husband and the wife, we're already starting off on the wrong foot. Because guess what? I don't care how much y'all love each other. I don't care how strong and tight and deep that thing is. It's just a matter of time. Y'all gonna get on each other's nerves. All the married folk like, yep. Y'all don't want to look at your spouse, though. But everybody looking at me. Ain't nobody looking over at you. You know, they're just like, Yeah. It's normal. It happens. It happens. Because I tell you what, I don't care how happy she makes you. She did not save you. I don't care how good a care she takes of you. She can't watch over you 24/7. She can't keep your blood pumping warm in your veins. She can't rise you up in the morning and lay you down at night. She can't hold you and wipe the tears from your eyes all the time. Because sometimes she is the reason for your tears. Sometimes he is the reason for your stress. He is not supposed to complete you, and she is not supposed to complete you. Jesus Christ is the only one. The Bible says that fulfillment is found in him. For the word says it is in him that we live and move and have our being. Jesus says that until you find a place of putting me in the right place in regards to your relationships, it will always undermine your discipleship. Jesus isn't telling you now to neglect your family. No. But when I understand my relationship with Christ, it influences who I am to my family. When I realize that who I am as a father is an expression of my discipleship, when I take God more serious, I take my role as a father more serious. When I take God more serious, I take my role as a husband more serious. When I take God more serious, then I have a better understanding of myself. Because guess what? Jesus ain't just talking to married folk. He's talking to single folk too. Because, you know, we got some single folk like, that's why I ain't getting married. I'm my own person. I ain't looking for nobody to whatever, whatever. I done tried that before, and it didn't work out. So, no, Jesus said you got to be even willing to hate yourself. You realize that what is fundamental to discipleship is the discipline of self-denial. Jesus says elsewhere in another gospel, he says that if any man comes after me, let him first deny himself, take up his cross daily, and follow me. For whoever wants to find his life will lose it. That's the word. That ain't me, man. That ain't Earl talking. That's Jesus talking. And so Jesus is telling us then that real disciples make Jesus the center of all of their affections and relationships. And so we got to tell people, you know what? I love you too much to let you use me up like this. Oh, yeah. Sometimes, you know, you got to, one way to love people properly is to tell them no. One way to honor God in marriage is to know when to say no. One way to honor God as a parent is knowing when to say no. You know, buying our children everything they want doesn't make us a good parent. Making sure, you know, we say things like, I want my kids to have more than what I had growing up. That doesn't necessarily make you a good parent. Because, you know, a lot of parents are aching right now because their kids got more than what they ever had, and now they got more stress than what they ever had. All tied up in knots and messed up because their children just seem to see them as a walking ATM machine. See you as nothing but Toys R Us, a means to an end. But when we understand the relationship with Christ and we're making sure that Jesus gets the best of our affections, it cannot help but enhance who we are in our other relationships. That's what he wanted his disciples to understand. That's what he wanted the crowds to know. He's saying, listen, this ain't no game rolling with me. If you're going to be with me, you got to be with me for real. And being with me means then that you can't tell me to hold up because you got to go check on something at the crib. Jesus like, no, you handle this and the crib will take care of itself. I told you, it's going to be a little different preaching right here. But this is going to help us because this is what it means. This is the essence of the Christian life. And Christianity. This message, these teachings of Jesus are countercultural. These teachings of Jesus, they are contrary to the status quo. These teachings of Jesus, they turn upside down the constructs that we have of Western thought and culture. That we ascribe, just like the Jews, that we would ascribe spirituality to material stuff. The more stuff I have, it's indicative of the depth of my spirituality. Because if I got more stuff, it means that God is blessing me more. And therefore, I try to engage God from the vantage point of trying to get more stuff. Jesus is saying, I ain't trying to give you more stuff. I want more of you. Let me go to the second point. Second point is this then. My life is no longer my own. He says that you got to be even willing to hate yourself. Hate even his own life. If man doesn't hate his own life, he cannot be my disciple. I cannot be self-serving and a disciple. I cannot try to always figure out how I come out on top and call myself a disciple of Jesus Christ. Because that is a total slap in the face of the life that Christ lived. The Bible says that the Son of Man comes to seek and to save that which was lost. Jesus did not come into the world to make a name for himself. Jesus did not come into the world that the world may bow down to him. Jesus came into the world to serve the world, that the world may be able to come up at his expense. And so that is totally against how we live our lives. We live wanting more. We want more notoriety. We want more prosperity. We want more of this. We want more time. We want more health. We want all of this, and it comes out in our prayers. God, I need this. God, I need that. God, make this. God, fix that. God, open that. We want the world to revolve around us. It is this narcissistic spirituality, self-serving. And Jesus says that you must be willing to hate yourself if you want to be one of my disciples. Don't push back on me. That's what the Word of God says. The Apostle Paul says that we are nothing more than filthy rags in the eyes of God. That Paul is telling us that our lives are nothing without Jesus Christ. And therefore, instead of trying to make myself more of something, I ought to be trying to empty myself for the glory of God. Whoever loses his life will find it. Now, I know that there's nothing wrong with desiring nice things. But I just believe that Jesus would want us to understand, I didn't hang on the cross just for you to have nice things. Socially, you know, we're in some uncharted waters right now in our government, in our nation. You know, we are now under the leadership of a president that is very controversial. I can say that. I'm not up here to defend him, nor am I up here to condemn him. I'm saying that he is making claims that are very controversial. And guess what? We have always been at the center of controversy. And what I mean by we, I'm not talking about African Americans. I'm talking about Christians. The God that we serve was a God of controversy. The Christ that we followed was a Christ of controversy. And the controversy, our controversy is this, that perhaps maybe God doesn't want you to have all of the stuff that you have right now. Maybe God is saying that maybe I blessed you so that you could bless someone else. Maybe God is saying that maybe I need you to put yourself on the line. I need you now to show some activism on behalf of someone else. That you must be willing to hate yourself if you're willing to be my disciple. You got to ask yourself, do I hate myself enough? Is my self-hatred enough? Does it match my expression of discipleship? Now, I know we love to talk about self-esteem and all that, man. You know, think, man, this, what's wrong with this guy? Talking about hating myself. But Jesus says that we must be willing to lose our lives. Now, I can lose my life, but I'm not going to lose my sense of self-worth. I know what I'm worth. That's two totally different things. Jesus is telling us to lose our lives, but don't lose your sense of self. Don't lose your value. Know what you're worth, and what you're worth is the blood of Jesus Christ. I don't care what kind of labels you put on me. They can label you whatever they want, but they did not die for you. And they will try to label you and put you in places and put you in boxes and put you in the stuff that you don't fit. But the point is this, that God said that I'm worth so much more. But it's because of who God says that I am. So we have to live in this tension of knowing my worth. But I don't have to run around trying to tell you what I'm worth. And I don't have to dress myself up so that you know that I'm worth something. I don't have to overinvest in things to get other people to see that I'm worth something. Because, see, if I got to try to convince you that I'm worth something, then I haven't convinced myself. Jesus says we must be willing to hate ourselves. So there is a connection between the material life and discipleship. You remember Jesus had a conversation with the rich young ruler. The rich young ruler asked about how can he have eternal life, and Jesus said that you need to love your neighbor as yourself. He said, well, I'm doing that. I'm loving everybody. It's good in my world. I ain't mad at nobody. Jesus said, go and sell everything you have and give to the poor. And the Bible says he walked away sad, like, oh, no. Can't do that. Guess what? None of us in here are necessarily rich young rulers. But when it comes time to having to give up stuff that is near and dear to us, we too walk away with our heads hung down. Got to be willing to hate yourself, because guess what? Your life is not your own. I'm going to press the envelope a little bit further and let you go. This point right here then. I must be willing to endure suffering. I'd even go further, intensify and say, you got to be willing to embrace suffering. Do you know that there's no guarantee that because you have professed faith in Christ that your life now is going to be easy? There's nothing in Scripture that will corroborate the notion that if you give your life to the Lord, all your troubles going to go away. All of the, I don't care, you would tear the Bible apart trying to preach a gospel that says that life is a life of financial wealth and good health and all of that. Because just last week we celebrated the life of the richest woman a lot of us know, and she didn't have a whole lot of money, but you couldn't tell her that her God wasn't real. And cancer took her body, but her soul was alive and well. That, you know what? Jesus never told us that if you walk with me, you're going to have it all right. In fact, Jesus said, in this life, you will have tribulation. But be of good cheer, for I have overcome the world. Therefore, I'm not going to sell you a bill of goods. I'm not going to tell you that if you just give your life to Jesus, you ain't going to have no troubles. I don't preach that kind of gospel. I don't tell people, just give your hand to the Lord. It's going to all be all right. If anything, it might get a little bit worser when you trust the Lord, when you walk with God, because you may have to go through some stuff, but going through that stuff, that's the only way sometimes that we get to see that God is real. That it's not until I have been through the fire that I know that heaven is real. It is not until I've hit rock bottom in life and know that the Lord is there and he's holding me and keeping me. It is not until folks have walked out on me and turned their backs on me that I realize that Jesus is a friend that sticks closer than a brother. That I don't need people around me because people are fickle and they'll walk away from you when you need them. People don't make me who I am. God makes me who I am. And Jesus says that if you're going to come after me, you got to be willing to take up the cross in my name. And taking up the cross ain't got nothing to do with what you hang around your neck. He wasn't talking about jewelry when he was talking about the cross. Oh, no. He was talking about suffering. If the cross becomes the universal symbol of suffering, and suffering is fundamental to the Christian life. Don't let anybody tell you that you are wrong if you are sick, that you don't have enough faith if your body fails. Stop reading something that tells you there's something wrong with your prayers. If nothing changes, it might just be that God is saying, this is how it will be, but I will be with you every step of the way. When we suffer, God is on display in our lives. The Apostle Paul prayed 3 times that the thorn would be taken from his flesh, and God never responded until he said, my grace is sufficient. And therefore, God didn't say, okay, I'm going to take it away from you. You suffered long enough. The Lord said, the thorn going to stay. But my grace is going to be there as well. And the Apostle Paul said, when I'm weak, that's when I'm strong. And so you know what? Some stuff you've been praying about, it might just be with you. And you just got to keep on praying. But you also going to know the Lord, I know your grace is sufficient. You can keep on praying, Lord, if it be your will, let this thing come away from me. But your grace is sufficient. The Lord may be saying, it is not time yet. You got to keep on suffering, but I'm walking right there with you. The Lord may be saying, I'm here. I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. And so you got to add some stuff into your prayers, like I'm more than a conqueror. You got to keep saying, now unto him who is able to do exceedingly and abundantly above more than I could ever ask or imagine. The Lord is my shepherd and I shall not be in want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He restores my name for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. No weapon formed against me shall prosper. Greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. That we got to learn how to appropriate our suffering. That when we suffer, it doesn't mean that we are bad. And when we suffer, it doesn't mean that God is bad. The Lord gives and the Lord takes away. But blessed be the name of the Lord. And therefore, I got to still give him praise. When I'm up, I'm going to give him praise. And when I'm down, I'm going to give him praise. Praise is what I do. Even when I'm going through the good times and the bad, I won't complain. That's what Paul Jones said. Sometimes the clouds hang low and I can hardly see the road. And so here we need to understand what this whole business of suffering is. You know what? There is no crown with no cross. There is no resurrection with no crucifixion. There's no victory without battle. Guess what? There's no pain. There's no gain where there's no pain. That we will have trouble. We will have scars. We will have heartache. We will have pain. But that's what it costs to be a disciple. That's what it costs to walk with God. That's what it costs to be one of his children. That's what it costs to be God's man. Real men, they know how to endure pain. Real men know how to endure suffering. Real women know how to endure suffering. Real women know how to stay faithful. When it gets hot, we don't get out of the fire. We hunker down. We bunker down. We pray to the Lord of the harvest. When life gets rough, we don't throw up our hands and complain. We go in deeper into our prayer closet and we call on the name of the Lord. When life backs us against the wall, all we do is put up our dukes and we fight, but we fight from our knees. And we call on the God of heaven and we tell him all about our troubles and we understand it better by and by when the morning comes, when all of God's children are gathered together at home, we'll tell the story of how we overcome and we'll understand it better by and by. Maybe some suffering, but there's still going to be grace. Maybe rough on the journey, but it will be worth every bit of it. Because you know what? If I'm going to live an unleashed life, I got to understand that there's some people that I got to be able to say no to. If I'm going to live an unleashed life, I'm also going to have to tell myself no. If I'm going to live an unleashed life, I got to know that there may be some suffering along the way. But that's all right, because at the end of all of it, underneath all of it, behind all of it, at the front of all of it, God is there in the center. And God is keeping me. God is blessing me. God is watching over me. God is holding me. God is holding stuff back. God is carrying me through some stuff. The Lord is opening doors that no man can open. God is blocking some stuff. There are people out there trying to plot your demise, but the Lord is holding you in place. There are people that don't want to cheer for you. They want to tear you down, but the Lord is keeping you right where you are. There are sicknesses out there trying to take your body, but the Lord is letting Tylenol keep on working in your body. The Lord is doing some stuff on your behalf, and that's what it means to be a disciple. I ain't gotta have a big house and a fancy car. I got the blood of Jesus that came streaming down, the blood that climbs to the highest mountain and flows to the lowest valley, the blood that flows and gives me strength from day to day, the fountain that is filled with blood drawn from Emmanuel's vein. And when sinners plunge beneath that flood, they'll lose all of their guilty stains. That's what it means to follow God Amen. Amen. I just got to stop somewhere. I ain't done, but I got to stop today. We'll pick it back up next week. But just know that God is in this thing. That God is on his throne. That God is watching over you. That God is keeping you. That God knows your struggle. God knows your pain. But you belong to him. He bought you. He paid for you. He's taken care of you. He's holding you. He's consoling you. God has not left you. God has not turned his back on you. Just trust him. Trust in the Lord. That's what unleashed living is about. It's about maturity, surrendering to God in every area of my life. This is not something that I just do on Sundays. I don't treat my Christianity like it's one of my hobbies. It's not something, you know what I like to do on Sunday mornings is I like to get up and put on my good stuff. I like to spend an extra few minutes in the mirror. And I like to go to this little place in town called New Hope Baptist Church. I like to go in there because they sing this music that is so uplifting. I like to go there on Sunday mornings because I find myself whatever. No, this ain't no game for us. That's what folk can't realize. If I don't get to church, if I don't do anything else, I got to get with some folk who know about the power of God. After the week that I've had, and I don't wait till Sunday. I sometimes I got to go and close myself up in my office sometimes because my supervisor working my nerves. You don't know how many times I thought about walking off of my job, but it was only the grace of God. If you knew the stuff that I got to take week in and week out, this ain't no game for me. You don't know what I got to go through day in and day out, what I got to wrestle with, what I got to fight with. If you looked in my cupboard, you wouldn't realize why I look so healthy. If you saw my medicine cabinet, you would swear I had a pharmacy in the house, but I don't. If you saw my gas tank, you would wonder, how can I make it back and forth across town? I tell you, it's only by the grace of God. That's what it means to live the unleashed life, that you know that you are nothing without God. Hey, I was supposed to be stopping. Let me stop. Let me stop this way and just settle myself just enough to say, listen, there may be somebody with us this morning. And you are trying your best to make life make sense for you. But you tried it all these ways without considering God's perspective. Maybe you've lived your life with some appreciation for God and Christ. You know, you've talked highly, you've spoken highly of Jesus. You talked about, yeah, my grandmama, she was some kind of woman. She loved the Lord. She always used to read the Bible to me before I went to bed, and she bought me a little stuff and all that. You know, you speak highly of Jesus. You know, you ain't got nothing bad to say about Jesus. But you realize now, you know, I was just a fan. Jesus don't need fans. He's not flattered by fans. But he's honored by disciples. And guess what? You can be a disciple today. Don't think now, well, I don't know all them scriptures and stuff. I can't be a disciple. Yes, you can. Scripture and stuff will come. But you'll be a disciple when you finally say yes. When you surrender. When you acknowledge, you know what? I need this in my life. I need this discipline. I realize that I only live because Jesus died in my place. I need the strength and the power of God. This appeal is for you. There may be somebody here and saying, you know what, I need that for me. I need to walk out of here knowing that God is working in my life. That I need to walk out of here knowing beyond a shadow of a doubt, I'm going to be all right. Not because of what somebody else told me, not because of what I got coming this week in the mail. I'm going to be all right because God is protecting me. That I'm going to be all right because I have literally placed myself in his hands. If that appeal is for you, why don't you just come, just move this way. Our counselor's going to stand. You don't have to, you know, you're not going to have to say one word to this congregation today. You don't have to turn around and tell everybody why you've come. God bless you. Yes, we're ready to receive you. Somebody else in here, you thinking about it. You see, we didn't stop her. We didn't say, hold on, tell us what your name is and why you come. We're not going to do that to you. We're going to take her into a room and she's going to receive counsel in privacy. Whatever questions she has, they're going to answer them. She's going to begin an official relationship with this church. You may have surrendered your life to Jesus Christ years ago, long time ago, but you're not connected to a local church. You know, that's all you're doing is missing out on all of what that relationship can afford you. In fact, you cannot be your greatest self apart from the church. The Christian life was a life never meant to be lived in isolation. The way you become a Christian, you got to do it in community. A fish can't swim out of water. A Christian can't live outside of the church. That's the word. That's the will of God. God does something special with his people in the church. Guess what? You may know some of us in here and know what we used to be. You may have seen what some of us were doing even last night. You may know some of our contradictions. Guess what? That when we get together, the Lord blesses us and the Lord uses us. And just because you might know something about me doesn't make you any better than me. You still need the same grace that I need. The only difference is that some of us, not too proud to admit, yeah, I got some issues. Yeah, you heard me use some language. It's probably not the best choice of words for a disciple. And the Lord is working on me on that. I'm not telling you it's all right to be cussing. I'm not saying that. But I'm just telling you that ain't none of us in here perfect. And so you need this community. You need a community that will nurture you, that will affirm your gifts. We want to believe in you. We want to be your biggest cheerleader. We want to show up at your proud moments, and we want to be there for your dark moments as well. You need this body. You need this fellowship. It's what makes the congregation special. It's when God takes people from all walks of life who are facing all kind of darkness, all kind of trouble, all kind of challenges, and he works in all of their lives, and they all gain strength from each other. We want to be that for you. If you're here, why don't you come? Why don't you come? Just get up from wherever you are. Just come this way. I promise you, you'll be connected with the right people. Nobody's in here is going to judge you. We're not going to go and run background check on you. We're not going to check your credit. We're not going to ask you for references. We're not going to do all that investigating. We're going to support you. We're going to pray for you. We're going to nurture you. Make sure that you evolve and grow into being the very best self that you can be. Amen. Amen. Let's thank God today for his word. Let's thank him for our sister who has come today. Amen. 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 It's now time for us to worship at the table now as we fellowship around the Lord's table for the Lord's Supper. I'm going to ask God. If you're seated over here in this overflow, if you make your way over into the main floor, if you sit on the main floor, you all start moving this way, start moving towards the center. That will help us tremendously. If you're seated over here in this section, if you'd move, start moving toward the center. Everybody that you see over there, they got to sit in this section. That will help us be efficient. Thank you so much. Don't be offended if somebody asks you to scoot over a little bit.